Okay, Michael, so let's look at this little line segment, okay? And let's say I've got 10 little points that I could put down on this line segment, and I want them all to represent some part of this line, all right? That's kind of k-nearest neighbor-ish. So I'll put a little x here, I'll put one here, and I'll put one here, put one here, put one here, 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 here. Is that 10? 3, 6, 9, 10, 10, okay? And let's pretend I did the right thing here, and I have them kind of uniformly distributed across the line segment. So that means each one of these points is sort of owning an equal size subsegment of this segment. Does that make sense?
Yeah, so it's representing it in the sense that that point, when you're trying to estimate values of other places on the line, it's going to default as the nearest neighbor to being that point. So there's a very small little neighborhood of the red line segment that is covered by each of the green X's.
That's exactly right. And in fact, each one of these green X's represents how much of this segment?
Each of the green X's covers 1/10.
That's exactly right. You cover 1/10. All right, Michael, so let's say that I move from a line segment now to a two-dimensional space, so a little square segment, if that's the right technical term. And I've taken my little 10 X's and I put them down here before. Well, so here's something you'll notice. You'll notice that each one of these X's is going to still end up representing 1/10 of all of this space, but you'll also notice that the 10th that it's representing is now, you know, really, 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 really big.
I see.
So one way of putting it is, you know, if you think about the farthest point as opposed to the furthest point, which would be incorrect. The farthest point that this particular first X over here is representing, it's got some distance here. Over here, the farthest point from this X, the distance is very, very far away. So a question would be, how could I make it so that each of the X's I put down represents the same amount of, I don't know, diameter or distance as the X's in this line segment over here? So what do you think I would have to do?
I feel like you need to fill up the square with X's.
Yeah, that's exactly right. So let's do that. So filling them up, Michael, as you suggested, you'll notice that, at least if we pretend that I drew this right, each of these X's is now going to end up being the nearest neighbor for a little square like this. And the diameter of these little squares are going to be the same as the diameter of these little line segments. Okay.
Yeah, I agree for some definition of the word, but diameter.
Yes, and for some definition if I drew them straight. Okay, so how many of these X's are there, Michael? Can you tell? You want to count?
I'm going to multiply because okay. It looks like you did 10 by 10, so that'll be 100.
That'll be 100. So each one now holds 1/100 of the space, and I went from needing 10 points to, of course, 100 points in order to cover the same amount of space.
All right, so that definitely seems like the mild rebuke of dimensionality.
Yes.
But it doesn't seem that bad.
Okay, well, what happens if I now move into three dimensions? So now if I want to cover the same amount of, you know, diameter space for, you know, sufficient definition of diameter, I'm going to have to do a bunch of copying and pasting that I'm not willing to do. So, you know, there'll be more X's here and, you know, there'll be X's here and there'll be an X here and I'll just kind of go and I'll fill up the space. And, you know, I'm not going to do this, whatever. And you'll get X's everywhere. And you notice I need a lot more X's than I had before. And by the way, I'm just showing you the outside of this little cube. There are actually X's on the inside as well that you can't see. How many X's do you think I have?
I don't think you drew any X's. You're just like scribbling on the side of the cube.
These are X's.
You were doing so well for a while and then just lost it entirely.
Well, wouldn't you lose it if you had to write 1,000 X's?
No, because I would use computers to help me. But yes, it is very frustrating to have that many X's. And but in particular, in this case, we're talking about data points in a nearest neighbor method. And that, boy, that does seem like a big growth from 10 to 100 to 1,000.
In fact, the growth is exponential.
Exponential.
Right. So if we went into four dimensions, which I'm not going to draw, then we would need... not 1,000, but 10,000 points. And in five dimensions, we would need 100,000 points. And in six dimensions, we would need 1,000,000 points, and so on and so forth. So something like 10 to the D, where D is the number of dimensions.
Wow.
Right. So this is really problematic, right? If I want in my little nearest neighbor method to be able to say, well, I want to make sure that the neighborhood remains small, as I add dimensions, I'm going to need to grow the number of points that I have in my training set exponentially. And that's really bad. And by the way, this isn't just an issue of K and N. This is true in general. Don't think about this now as nearest neighbors in the sense of K and N, but think of it as points that are representing or covering the space. And if you want to represent the same sort of hypervolume of space as you add dimensions, you're going to have to get exponentially more points in order to do that. And coverage is necessary to do learning. So the curse of dimensionality does not just apply to K and N. It is a curse of dimensionality for ML, period.
You mean for me?
Yes. The curse of Michael Lippmannality.
Okay. And that seems really problematic because it's very natural to just keep throwing dimensions into a machine learning problem. Like, it's having trouble learning. Let me give it a few more dimensions to give it hints. But really what you're doing is just giving it a larger and larger volume to fill.
Yeah, and it can't fill it unless you give it more and more data. So you're better off giving more data than you are giving more dimensions.
Soinks.
Mm-hmm. There's an entire series of lessons that we will get to eventually that deals with this issue.
The issue of?
Dimensionality.
Finding the right dimensionality?
Yeah.
That would be a useful thing.
It would, but it's far off in the future. It's like infinitely far in the future. So we'll worry about that in a few weeks.
Okay.
All right. So there you go, Michael. Curse of dimensionality is real, and it's a real problem.
Where did that term come from? It's a cool term.
I think it came from, what's his name? Bellman.
Oh, Bellman, like the dynamic programming guy.
Yeah, the dynamic programming guy. Bellman of Bellman equation guy.
Which we haven't gotten to yet in the course.
Which we haven't gotten to in the course, but we will get to in the course because it's central. So it looks like actually Bellman's central to a lot of things.
Wow.
Sometimes he gives us equations that helps us, but sometimes he gives us curses.
Curses, Bellman. Foiled again.